where it's going to sing. Let me find it here. The last mile of the way. To see everyone, and if we have any visitors, I don't see any, but we're just glad to have you. And as I've said before, if you're a member here, you're expected to be here tonight. Let's go to hymnals and turn to hymn number 475, Victory in Jesus. 475.
Thank you.
To hymn number 56. Number 56.
Thank you. He left the splendor of heaven for me, and he took on the likeness of man. He came to live in an ungodly world, though spotless the Lamb knew no sin. All heaven's foundation were shaken that day, but for changing his mind he could not. Though he knew exactly what he would go through,
oh, he must have loved me a lot. And how many tears have I brought to his eyes? I've heard him more often than not. Still infinite mercy responds to my cry. Oh, he must have loved me a lot.
He went through a shame of a trial alone, through the darkness of death and the grave. He went through the pain of denial and scorn, the outcast and beggars to save. If I had the power to turn back the time, make amends for the things I forgot, a lifetime of goodness could never atone.
Oh, he must have loved me a lot. And how many tears have I brought to his eyes? I've heard him more often than not. Still infinite mercy responds to my cry. Oh, he must have loved me a lot. And how many tears have I brought to his eyes? I've heard him more often than not. Still infinite mercy responds to my cry. Oh, he must have loved me a lot. Oh, he must have loved me a lot. Loved me a lot.
Our subject tonight is a love letter from heaven. A love letter from heaven. There are many of you that have encouraged your pastor by saying, "I love you." My children and grandchildren have said that, "I love you." But there's one human love letter that I get that's more important than those. If my wife says, "I love you," that's special to my heart. But when I think about God saying, especially one day when Jesus comes, And he says, Father, I and the children which thou'st given me. And if we die as God's child before Jesus comes, then I'm not going to speak for God, but I believe he's going to say, welcome home, my child. And I love you. John 13:1. Before the feast of the Passover, when Jesus knew that his hour was come, that he should depart out of this world unto the Father, having loved his own which were in the world, he loved them unto the end. To the end of what? To the end of his life at the cross. But it didn't stop there. He's still loving his own to the end. John 17:1. Seventeenth chapter of John speaks a number of times about the love of God, and it's a love beyond comprehension of man. Verse 1 said, these words spake Jesus, and lifted up his eyes to heaven, and said, Father, the hour's come. Glorify thy Son, that thy Son also may glorify thee, as thou hast given him power over all flesh, that he should give eternal life to as many as thou hast given him. And this is life eternal, that they might know thee, the only true God, and Jesus Christ, whom thou hast sent. But now in this same chapter, I want you to see verse 23 and 24. Why did God send his Son? The Lord Jesus now is speaking, of course, to his Heavenly Father. He said, I and them, thou and me, that they may be made perfect in one, and that the world may know that thou hast sent me. And here's the thing I want you to see. And hast loved them as thou hast loved me. Father, I will that they also whom thou hast given me be with me where I am, that they may behold my glory, as thou hast given me, for thou lovest me before the foundation of the world. But according to what was preached here Wednesday night last, God also loved his children in Christ before the foundation of the world. Before Adam ever sinned, God knew all about our sin, and he loved us despite it. But the thing that I've never grasped is the last part of verse 23, John 17. The Lord Jesus said that God has loved them, that is, his sheep, as thou hast loved me. I don't have any problem understanding how God could love his Son, who walked in perfect obedience always, who'd been beside him for eternity past to eternity future. But he loved the people of God with the same love that he had for his Son. Is that condescension? Is that grace? Is that mercy? It's everything you can think about it, and when you've said all you can think and say, you haven't scratched the surface. Chapter 18, verse 11. Then said Jesus unto Peter, put up thy sword into the sheath. The cup which my Father hath given me, shall I not drink it? You know what motivated that statement? Love. Then chapter 19, verse 25. This week, as I went over this and read it and thought about it and meditated on it and tried to pray over it, I tried to visualize this scene at the cross. The darkness is about to descend. God the Father is about to turn his back upon his Son. The wrath of God is about to fall. And the Bible says, now there stood by the cross of Jesus, his mother's sister Mary, the wife of Cleophas, and Mary Magdalene. When Jesus therefore saw his mother, I want you to know something tonight. The one that died on that cross was a man. Now I know he's God, but he was a man with feelings. When he saw his mother and the disciple standing by whom he loved, that's the Apostle John, he saith unto his mother, Woman, behold thy son. Then saith he to the disciple, Behold thy mother. And from that hour that disciple took her unto his own home. And in some sense, Mary became the mother of John the Baptist, and he became her benefactor. But do you know why? The love of God in both of them. And Jesus Christ loved his mother at the very moment that he was to drain the cup of God's wrath. He loved her. It wasn't necessary for this message tonight, but I knew it was there, and I thought it was worth considering. Now, who do I preach to tonight? In a special way, to those that sorrow, those that suffer, those that have sin that so easily besets, that's struggling over some sin. But a love letter from heaven. I'm saying to you, a love letter from the very throne of God, the eternal God of the heavens, the eternal sovereign of the universe. If you get a love letter from him, no matter the sorrow that you're suffering right this moment, Jesus Christ is saying to you, I love you. That's what he's saying. In the 40th Psalm, for a moment tonight, Psalms 40. I believe tonight that Psalm 40 is a messianic psalm. Now, by having said that, that means that when you read it, there may be a verse or two that applies to David, the human instrument, and then there's some verses that apply only to the Lord Jesus. Psalm 40, verse 6. Sacrifice and offering thou didst not desire. Mine ears hast thou opened. For an offering and sin offering hast thou not required. I'll show you in this next verse, you won't have any problem knowing it's a messianic psalm, because you find this same quote in Hebrews. Then said I, Lo, I come. In the volume of the book it's written of me. I delight to do thy will, O my God. Yea, thy law is within my heart. I have preached righteousness in the great congregation. Lo, I have not refrained my lips, O Lord, thou knowest. I have not hid thy righteousness within my heart. I have declared thy faithfulness and thy salvation. I have not concealed thy loving kindness and thy truth from the great congregation. Withhold not thou thy tender mercies from me, O Lord. Let thy loving kindness and thy truth continually preserve me. For innumerable evils have compassed me about. Mine iniquities have taken hold upon me. I want to stop for a moment there. How could this be a messianic psalm and yet that statement be made, mine iniquities? I believe I know the answer. When Jesus Christ in the covenant of grace, agreed with his heavenly Father about the elect. He took personal responsibility for their sins because of his love. Mine iniquities have taken hold upon me so that I'm not able to look up. They're more than the hairs of my head. Therefore my heart faileth me. Be pleased, O Lord, to deliver me, O Lord. Make haste to help me. Let them be ashamed and confounded together that seek after my soul. Hearken back to this morning to destroy it. Let them be driven backward and put to shame that wish me evil. Let them be desolate for a reward of their shame that say unto me, aha, aha. Let all those that seek thee rejoice and be glad in thee. Let such as love thy salvation say continually, the Lord be magnified. To me, to my heart tonight, that's a love letter from heaven. Jesus Christ, when these words are penned, had already uttered them in his own heart. When? Way back there, before there was a man, before there was an earth, all of this was already in the mind of the Savior. Why did he not come down from the cross? Because he loved. He said, the cup then which my Father hath given me, shall I not drink it? The cross, my brothers and sisters, was in full view. And I want you to know something tonight. It was not something that he looked forward to except as he did so by loving his people. I don't think he looked forward and say, oh, I can't wait to be nailed to that cross. He didn't do that. But I tell you what John 18:11 says to me. It tells me that there was total, absolute, full, complete obedience to the Father's will. There was no resistance, no falling back, no murmuring, no refusing. And Peter said he left us an example that we should follow him. Now what does this say? It says this to me, and I'm going to speak in the first person. The cup which my Father hath given me, shall I not drink it? I'm not going to be nailed to a cross, but whatever God brings, I am to receive it as a love gift from my Heavenly Father. Whatever it is. My brothers and sisters, whatever he sends, I am to see it in that light. Who else ought to think about this? Jim and Ronnie, Claude and Randy, Paris and Frank, Wiley and Benny, and Morris, Dave and Bill and Ray, and any of the rest of us who are here tonight. Whatever he sends, he does it because he loves us. Why do we chasten our children? Oh, what a poor example. Because we want them to be blessed in the future. You that are parents tonight with children that are almost to the age to leave the nest, don't you want what's best for them? Sure you do. Well, so does the Lord, and the difference in him and us is we don't know all the time what's best for our children, but he knows. He knows. So I must not then kick against what he sends. Now I confess before you tonight that your pastor wishes sometimes that he were able to do more And then I come to my senses and know that I'm doing all that the Lord has destined for me to do. See, I know that. When I think God's way, and wherever He has me tonight, and wherever He has you, if we're God's blood-bought children, we ought to be able to go back to our homes tonight before we lie down upon beds to rest. We ought to be saying, "Oh, thank you, Lord, that you saved the unworthy because you loved." He's all wise. He makes no mistakes. He sends nothing that would ever harm us. You know, I preached that all of these years, and some of us, maybe starting with the pastor, haven't learned it yet. He never sends anything that's not good for us. In the book of Job, it talks about man. You know what it says about him? He said he's born like a wild ass's colt. You know what that means? We're not born loving God. We're born, as I tried to say this morning, with that inherent hatred of God. And to think that He would come to us in the midst of spiritual darkness and cause us to live. I looked at these three that sung tonight. I don't know their hearts. But oh, I thank God that some in my family claim to know the same Savior. That's a love letter to heaven from me. You remember Romans 8:28? Let's examine that verse just for a minute. All things work together for good to who? To them that love the Lord, the called according to His purpose. What do you mean all things? You mean if you break your leg, lose part of your lung? All things work together for good. Now let's look together in Gospel of John, just three or four verses in John 14th chapter and 15th verse. If you've had a love letter from heaven, look at what this one says. The Lord Jesus in John 14:15. If you love me, keep my commandments. I always talk about things that just affect me, and I told you where, if I heard those words from my wife that says, "I love you," that does a lot for me. But when I think about my Savior, my wife couldn't die on the cross for me. She had her own sins. I couldn't die for her. But Jesus Christ died for both of us. You know what He says to us? Serve me. I loved you. I loved you first. I loved you when you weren't seeking me. But if you love me, keep my commandments. Keep my commandments. Keep my commandments. So from our side, if we've experienced a love letter from heaven, whatever He wants, we ought to do it. Look down verse 23. If a man love me, he will keep my words. Brother Gormley told me some years ago, and I didn't put him on the prayer list tonight, but he's still ill, not preaching. Hadn't been out. But he said, God's sheep hear His voice, and they follow Him. And what he forgot to tell me was, they follow Him because the love of God shed abroad in their hearts. But his point was, you don't have to make them. You don't have to make somebody serve God. If a man love me, he'll keep my words. And what happens? He said, my Father will love him. We'll come unto him, make our abode with him. He that loveth me not, keepeth not my sayings. Very simple, isn't it? In John 15, look at verse 12. The Lord Jesus, I want to tie this in with us tonight. This is my commandment, that you love one another as I have loved you. You know what that obligates me to? To love every member of this church who knows the Savior. Greater love hath no man than this, that a man lay down his life for his friends. But the Lord Jesus said, you're my friends if you do whatsoever I command you, and he commands us to love each other. So we need to be awfully careful we don't do anything to harm one of God's little lambs or God's sheep. Now, what does natural man do when God crosses his will? He certainly doesn't love. But you know what he does? When you're trying to get a church member who's not saved to love and serve God, they don't want that. They can't do that because they've never had a love letter from heaven. Regenerated man, you know what happens to him? That spirit of rebellion, like that wild ass's colt, is subdued. I've confessed this many times, and I do it one more time at least. When I was lost, I wouldn't have cared if every last one of you died and went to heaven. But regenerated man then has the love of God shed abroad in his heart. He's a new creature in Christ. The old nature is still knocking on the door. You know what your pastor has been doing? He's trying to put into practice what he preached to you last Sunday morning. So what you talking about? On the Lord's Day, I'm trying not to think and speak and do that which I do the other 6 days. And oh, what a battle it is. But the regenerated child of God who's had a love letter from heaven knows that he needs Christ to calm the storms that come. What kind of storm? Resentment, discontent, even refusing, Brother Benny, to do the known will of God. But when I remember Calvary, and when I remember the mountain of my sin, to refuse to obey him is a sinful thing to my own mind and heart. To each of you and to myself, the children of God can sorrow with you, and we ought to when you sorrow. Children of God can be concerned for you. Children of God can put their arms around you and try to comfort you. But the one who can do the most for you is the same one who died on Calvary's tree. He can bind up the brokenhearted, Isaiah said. He can proclaim liberty to the captives, Isaiah said. He can open the prison to them that are bound. Peter put it another way, casting all your cares upon him, for he careth for you. Tonight I look into your faces, and some of you I've pastored for a long time. And many of you and many of us have lost dads or moms or both. Some have lost a brother or sister. Some have lost a husband or a wife. Some have lost a child. Some have lost friends. And the waters of bereavement run deep. But we can be comforted by the promises that are in the Word of God. And if you live for a while, you're going to suffer some more. What promises do we have? I want to show you one that's very precious to my own heart in Job chapter 1, verse 18. Job 1:18, the Bible said, while he was yet speaking, there came also another and said, thy sons and thy daughters were eating and drinking wine in their eldest brother's house. And behold, there came a great wind from the wilderness and smote the four corners of the house, and it fell upon the young men, and they're dead. And I only am escaped alone to tell thee. Now, the Bible gives us a response of a man named Job. Before we read his response, I want to say a little bit about Job. Job was a man just like we are. Job was a man that if you cut him, he'd bleed. Job was a man who had emotions. Job was a man who could suffer. And look what he said, what he did. Job arose, rent his mantle, shaved his head, fell down upon the ground and worshiped. You know what he did? He bowed himself to the sovereign purpose of Almighty God. Look at what he said. Naked came I out of my mother's womb. Naked shall I return thither. The Lord gave and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. In all of this, Job sinned not, nor charged God foolishly. One of the precious moments in my life has to do with the death and the funeral of Sister Gormley. I know I've told you about it a few times. But just before that funeral, Brother Gormley walked over to me and said, the Lord gave and the Lord hath taken away. Blessed be the name of the Lord. I knew he was going to suffer. I knew he was suffering. But I knew also that he's going to be all right. And he loved her. But he knew God gave her, and he knew God took her away, and he knew one day he'd see her in a place called heaven. And I say to you, that's living. Word of God tells us, keep on trusting. Keep on looking unto Jesus, the author and the finisher of our faith. Don't ever forget Isaiah 26:3. He whose mind is stayed on Jehovah is kept in perfect peace. He will never fail us. Before I quit tonight, since you're close by here, turn to Jeremiah chapter 1. And we're going to read verse 5. And I want you to know something tonight. If you're God's child or you're in his eternal purpose to make you one, did you know that God's always loved you? Always. He told Jeremiah in verse 5, Jeremiah, before I formed thee in the belly, I knew thee. Before thou camest forth out of the womb, I sanctified thee and I ordained thee prophet unto the nations. Maybe I've been a little emotional, a little personal tonight, but it comes back to mind that a set of grandparents prayed that God would save one of their grandsons and call him to preach. Over and over and over. It wasn't this one. They picked out another one. They thought they knew who it was, but God answered. See. Now in Jeremiah chapter 31. Chapter 31 of Jeremiah. Verse 3 and verse 11. The Lord hath appeared of old unto me, saying, Yea, I have loved thee with an everlasting love, and therefore with have I drawn thee. I could use that as a way of invitation tonight very easily and say to you, even before we finish, got 3 or 4 minutes to go, that if you understand that God has spared you till this hour, and He's not put you in hell where your sins deserve to send you, that He's been long suffering, and you see the great love of God, then come to Jesus. Look at verse 11. The Lord hath redeemed Jacob and ransomed him from the hand of him that was stronger than he. Implied in that verse to my own mind and heart is this truth, that Satan was far stronger than any of us, but God sought us and saved us and drove Satan off the throne of our hearts. What great love that he had for his own. And Lamentations, also written by Jeremiah, chapter 3 and verse 21. Next book, Lamentations. Starting with verse 21. This I recall to my mind, therefore have I hope. It is of the Lord's mercies that we're not consumed, because His compassions fail not. They're new every morning. Great is thy faithfulness. Those that were privileged to hear Brother Lonnie Bennett preach, is my portion, saith my soul, therefore will I hope in Him. The Lord is good unto them that wait for Him, to the soul that seeketh Him. It is good that a man should both hope and quietly wait for the salvation of the Lord. My last verse tonight is Ephesians chapter 3, verse 19. Let me start with verse 18. Paul praying here for the saints at Ephesus and anyone else who will read it and believe it, that you may be able to comprehend with all saints what is the breadth and the length and the depth and the height, and to know the love of Christ which passeth knowledge, that you might be filled with all the fullness of God. So if I fail love of God, that's because I don't know how to take it to where it ought to be. Again, for the unsaved person who may be in this audience, if you want to see the love of God, go to the cross. A couple of verses come to mind. God, for us, he who knew no sin, that we of God in him. If you want to know about the great love of God, you see that he so loved the undeserving that he was willing to hang his son on that cruel tree and pour out his wrath upon him for those sins that I could have suffered for in the fires of hell for cause of his perfect humanity, he being all God and all man, he was able to suffer in the house of the hell-deserving sinner. To him by faith tonight, you can leave here with the same love of God shed abroad in your heart. Nothing else will take you to heaven save that precious blood. Says it's the blood. It's still the blood. Blood. Can you trust him tonight? I heard Mr. Cain this morning. Sometimes I don't understand all he says, but I think he cried because some are lost. Some are lost. A husband, you've got a wife, you've got a child who's lost. You know what it means to be lost? It means to be bad lost. You may see them again. See them cast to walk before them. You know what they'll do? When you slip up one time, they'll remind you, I thought you were a Christian. I thought you were saved. See, your failure because they'll be judged for their own sins. But if you can cast them all on and forgiveness, because that's what he promised. Please. We've tried to tell this audience about your love. We know we fail. Night. Because Jesus Christ has so loved. And you have so loved because you gave him that we might live eternally in your wrath of God to come, and Jesus. Amen.
Hymn 462.